Marco, thank you for coming.
Yeah, again, welcome everybody to this talk. So as stated, my name is Marco Pas. I currently work at Philips Lighting. What I do over there, you will see in a minute. Some stuff about me. I like to program. Last couple of years, I went into the whole DevOps, cloud area, that kind of space. And currently, I don't know if there are any Dutch native speakers over here. No? Chef leuke dingen doen. That means that I like to do stuff, trying out cool and new stuff. I'm actually part of Philips Research, where we take all kind of programming languages, platforms, and try what we can try to find out what we can do with them. So my current involvement is a big IoT project. So that's also why we use Amazon, for example. All the lighting systems, elements, sensors, and that kind of stuff are connected to a cloud platform where we collect data and do nice stuff with. So that's what got me involved in the whole AWS stuff. So quick inventory. Who of you is already using, for example, Docker? Already in production? Yeah? Oh, cool. Also in Amazon or somewhere else? Amazon? Google, maybe? Something else? I always tend to warn people which come from a Hello World tutorial doing Docker. Say, okay, now I have Docker and I can run my my platform in production. I always say, be warned. You can warn a lot, but you have to experience it. Then you go into a flow from, okay, I can start up my Docker Compose file, and it works, so I can ship my Docker Compose file to production, and it will work. And then you run into several issues, as here. What we saw, what we discovered, and probably most of you already know that, running a Docker Compose file is nice, or running a local Docker image is nice. But running it in production is a different beast. You have to worry about security, you have to worry about networking, you have to worry about monitoring and logging and that kind of stuff. That's something that a normal developer traditionally does not do. So running in production is totally different. So using Docker Compose does not mean that you can run it in production. What I will be telling you, and probably most of you already are familiar with Docker, so I'm going to quickly go to the whole container part and the creating a Spring Boot part. I will give you a short introduction on Amazon Container Services. Somebody of you already familiar with Amazon Container Services? Two? Three? Okay. Now, if you have any questions about it, please please ask them during the presentation or afterwards. No problem. I will be doing a small demo, so I will be pushing a demo container to Amazon. I will deploy the demo container on on ECS and see how we can reach that container. See how we can scale that container, so if we, for example, reach a certain amount of CPU load, how we can get additional Docker containers started by Amazon. And a short, small pieces about service discovery, logging and monitoring. So, quickly, containers, a lot of you already know it already. We started from using normal AMIs in Amazon. And we shifted, let's say, 2 years ago to using Docker containers. And that helped us a lot in deploying our infrastructure, managing our infrastructure, that kind of stuff. The stuff that helped us most was the automation part at the end, where we can build our Docker containers, push them, and get them automatically deployed. So basic thingy, basic Docker container, how you create them. You have a Docker file, which has some instructions in it. I will not go into the details. But you have some basic instructions where you actually package your application and you can deploy your application and build an image from it. So you build your image, do a Docker build from the Docker file, and you get your image. Then the concept of containers. So you have your image, now you want to create a container, so a running process from that container. So you start something, you start the Docker image, and then the result is a running container. And you can have as many running containers as you want, as long as your operating system or your cluster or your service allow you to do so. So what does it mean to create a container using Spring Boot? Spring Boot was chosen just as an example. In the current project we build containers from Scala projects, from Node.js projects, from all kinds of stuff, also including Spring Boot, also including Rails. But we have chosen to show you a bit on how we create our Spring Boot containers. So it's a simple demo application, nothing special. Prints out hello world. I cannot tell anything more about it. Prints hello world, that's it. So we have our request mapping in that Spring Boot application, that when you call the root endpoint, it prints out hello world. But then you come to a situation where you need to build that Docker container, and that's why where we modify the build pentakernel. First thing that we always add is Spring Boot Actuator to our Spring Boot applications. Actuator is actually needed by the Amazon infrastructure later on to check on the health endpoints of the application. So is the application alive? How's the disk space? Et cetera, et cetera. So we add the Spring Boot Actuator. We create a custom task for that in our build in Gradle. I often get the question, why don't you use any plugins in your Gradle projects to build your Docker containers? In the history, we encountered a lot of problems between operating system interoperability between those plugins. So we had some colleagues who ran on Windows, some colleagues who ran on Linux, and some other colleagues who ran on OS X, for example. And the containers that we could create with those plugins on OS X worked fine, on Linux worked fine, but our colleagues on Windows had a problem with that. Then you can state, okay, let everybody use a Linux environment or a Mac OS X environment. That's a bit cumbersome in a big organization. So at a certain moment, we decided, okay, let's step back. How can we create our containers? Everybody has the Docker installed on their system. Can't we reuse that? So what you see over here is when we do a Docker build, we just call the command line. So in our project, we have a Docker file, and we use the command line to actually build that Docker container. What we need to do about that is we need to shuffle around some code. So we need to copy the parts of the application, in this case the jar file or the WAR file, or rename some stuff, and put it into the correct order to be able to build a Docker container. One thing I forgot to mention is we tend to put a lot of metadata inside our containers. So like the git commit hash, that kind of stuff, the build dates and that kind of things. And for that we use replace tokens functionality, where you actually can take a Docker file with some placeholders into it, and you can replace that data on the fly when you build your Docker container. So in this case, this example, you see the version, the build date, the git branch, the git commit, something that we put in our Docker containers as metadata, so we can expose that and query that on the Amazon infrastructure. So here you see the label. So how, if you have that replace tokens, you just have a placeholder, and this gets automatically replaced. That's it. We do some housekeeping, create directories, create a startup script where you can actually fire up our Spring Boot application very easily. And we call an entry point, and we call that script. And at a certain moment, we have to also publish that Docker container. Now, normally you can build it to on your local system, and you have a local version, so that runs on your local host. But using, for example, a Docker Hub or something else, you have to assign a Docker registry to it, so you can expose or build the Docker container with a pre-label being the registry. And then we get some system environments. And we actually take the system environments and place them in front of the push. So that's what you see over here. So we can have multiple Docker registries depending on the system settings. Now, if you run that container, you guys are already familiar with Docker, Docker Compose, you build it and you can run it as easily. So if I would do that, let me show you a bit. We have a Docker images directory in this case. Okay? The size of the letters? Yeah? So we have our Spring Boot application. This is just a normal Spring Boot project. So what I did for the demo, created some shell scripts where we do a Gradle clean stuff. So we built a Spring Boot. We do the boot repackage stuff. So we get an executable jar file, WAR file. And then at a certain moment, I call the previous task, build a Docker image. So if I want to build this, what you will actually see in the on the top, you see that I install some stuff. For example, in this case, I install Stress. Stress is a small Linux utility, which I will be using later on when this Docker container is deployed in AWS. I can cause some stress inside this application. So we can do the auto-scaling. So I will call this utility later on. So this is simply how you build a Docker container. And you can run it if you want, but I will skip that. All right, so now we have an idea how to build Docker containers. We have our Docker files, we have our applications, that's all nice. But at a certain moment, we have to do something with those Docker containers. So forget about the Docker Compose stuff. That's usable, for example, in development, but not in production environments or in cloud environments. We need a container scheduler, container storage, and we need some orchestration. So we need to build our infrastructure. We need to store our Docker containers. And at a certain moment, we also need a service which states, okay, you're going to launch a Docker container. Where can I launch it? On which pieces of the infrastructure? So the container services. There are a couple of them. You have the Amazon ECS, which of course is which I will be showing you. You have also Kubernetes by Google. Anybody using Kubernetes, by the way? No. We tried that. It works also fine, but being a AWS-centric environment, we did not made a choice for Kubernetes. Docker Swarm is also a nice one. A recent newcomer on the block is HashiCorp Nomad. Some guys of you that already do some infrastructure probably know Terraform, for example, as a tool to create your infrastructure. And they also have Nomad, and that's their orchestration tooling for Docker-based environments. And you can also launch your Docker containers on Azure, which I did not try, by the way. But they all have the same focus, all those containers, all those services. They take your Docker containers and do something with it. So they are able to store your containers. They provide clustering support, for example, clustering in a way that you have multiple servers in your cluster where you deploy your Docker container, that at the end, the container service determines, okay, I will be putting this Docker container on server 1 or server 2 or server 3, etc. They expose APIs. Where you can scale up and scale down, that kind of stuff. See that. Also control and monitor APIs. We actually can have graphical overviews on how your Docker containers are doing. And they have flexible container placement. And placement is something that's often overlooked, but it has some powerful features. So if you have a clustering, or if you have a container service, being Amazon, being Google, whatsoever, and you have a container, you can often choose different placement strategies based on your needs. So you can say, for example, I have a Docker container. I want to always run it on a certain node. That's a strategy. You also have the spread strategy, where you can say, okay, I have a bunch of Docker containers. Doesn't matter where you run them, just do it. Binpack is a nice, interesting one. Binpack is a strategy where you, again, have a bunch of Docker containers, but where the container the container service actually decides, okay, I have four machines. Which is the machine which has the least amount of CPU power or memory, and I will try to fit it in there. So you can easily scale down on your number of machines inside a container cluster. And random, just do whatever you want. So you have the EC2 container service stuff. Working with Amazon is nice. I just took a snapshot of the services that they deliver. It's difficult to keep up what they create on a day-to-day basis. So if you look at the services that they deliver, you sometimes have to look, okay, where did my container service gone? Or what's the new addition? So they're pumping out stuff by the hour, as at least it feels. So if you look at AWS ECS, it actually consists out of two pieces. It actually consists out of the container registry. You can compare that with Docker Hub, so you can store your images over there, push your images, etc. And also pull them, and you have the container service. And the container service is something that I mentioned earlier on, is the stuff where you can deploy your containers in an infrastructure. So, small look at the container service and the ECR stuff. As stated, is the Amazon's version of Docker Hub, and it is very simple and basic one. You can create as many repositories if you want. You can do that via the UI or other means. But you always need to authenticate against that registry. Seems reasonable that you have to authenticate. What it does, you authenticate it against that registry and you get a token. And that token is stored on your machine or your CI server or whatsoever. And can you reuse that token for 12 hours. So you authenticate with credentials, get that token, and the token is used for pushing and pulling images. A nice thing about the Docker registry in this case, it's normally, for example, when our teams develop their software and the containers are pushed to Amazon, we have a certain process in place where we actually share our containers to a production environment on a certain moment. So we have split our environments into a development one and a production one, and our CI environment or manual intervention whatsoever just shares the container, the specific containers with another account where we do our production deployments. So how does that look like? So you build an image, same as we did earlier on. You do your build Docker image stuff, or you do your Docker build or whatsoever. So you have your image, and at a certain moment you need to push that, so you authenticate. You authenticate it goes by an eval command, and I will show that later on. You get that token, token is stored, and you can push it. Now, let me give you a small view on how ECS looks like, or ECR looks like. So, this is how ECR looks like, or ECS looks like. So, you have the clusters. We'll come later on, but you have your repositories. In this case, I've set up just a dummy account, which has one repository, Spring Boot Hello World repository. And if you want to create repositories, they're very simple. Just say, create a repository, create conf, hello world, next step, you get your commands. And this is actually how you would log in. So you call the AWS ECR get login, that gets you the token, and you can do stuff with that. Then you do a Docker tag, and you can push that Docker container to ECR. So now I have two repositories, which of one I will not be using. So you can create as many as you want. There are some limits, and at a certain moment, certainly if you have a big team, then you run into those limits, and then you have to call AWS or send a support ticket to increase it, the stuff. Now, let me push an image. Let me go to my scripts stuff. So I've just built that image, and I'm going to show you how I authenticate. This is the clear. This is how I authenticate in my way. So you can type that eval stuff. I created an Amazon profile called BOps. You can also make in your shell, some kind of stuff that you can automatically type. In this case, I need to authenticate like this. Now, this gets me authenticated. And then at a certain moment, I can push. Or push to ECR. What I do over here, I have my local Docker container. I do a retag. Retag, so I put the Docker registry in front of my newly built container. En dan doe ik Docker push. Push to ECR. Nou, you see we'll be pushing some stuff. Nothing fancy. And it will at a certain moment end up in this repository. So you see some images. You can also tag and whatever. whatever you like. All right, now we have our Docker containers inside the registry, but we also want to deploy them. So we need to see, okay, what Amazon provides in that. That's the ECS stuff. So I found the naming conventions of Amazon a bit difficult. So you have ECS, and ECS contains ECR, but also contains ECS. So if you have some naming stuff, it's totally explainable. So we want to run our Docker containers, in this case our Hello World stuff. The Docker container, so that's the result of an image that is being started by a scheduler. And that Docker container needs to land somewhere. In this case, in ECS, you need to have an EC2 instance, which you specifically assign for running containers. And Amazon has optimized AMIs for that. So they have ECS optimized AMIs, where you just can pick, say, okay, I want to deploy a new EC2 instance, and that should be of a specific type, and the type should be then a Docker optimized version for Amazon. And that thing can run Docker containers. It has two elements on it. So it has the ECS agent, and the ECS agent is actually just a piece of software, a small Docker container, which is launched on the instance, that is able to connect multiple EC2 instances inside a cluster. So on every machine you have in your cluster, you have the ECS agent installed automatically. And you have, of course, the Docker runtime. So once you have multiple container instances, you have your cluster. It's a logical grouping. And again, for people who already know Amazon, you can have auto-scaling groups, so your cluster can grow, can shrink, and whatsoever, based on several parameters. So this is how it all ties together. You have your container registry. It's automatically hooked up to the container instances. And container instances can pull images from that registry. For the demo, I need some infrastructure. I already created the infrastructure. I'll show you that in a moment. But what we're going to do is we're going to have a setup where we have a private and a public subnet. The private subnet will have a cluster, in this case, two machines. Otherwise, it will not be a cluster. You can also have one machine, by the way, but there are two in this cluster. We will launch a container on that. And that container exposes the Hello World via a load balancer. In the Amazon environment, you have the classical load balancers and the application load balancers. Some of you already using the application load balancers? No? The problem that we had with the classic load balancers on Amazon is you need to tie them to a specific instance of a Docker container. And with the application load balancer, you just can say, okay, I have multiple Docker containers providing a specific service. Doesn't matter. Just tie them all behind this load balancer. It has some nice features. Okay, this is something that we want to create. We need to create it. And I don't know if any of you just saw the other presentation where, I forgot his name, but he uses Terraform to do that. We also use it very heavily. So we use the infrastructure as code principle, where we also use Terraform, where we manage our resource life cycles, et cetera, which can manage your resources in Google, Amazon, or whatsoever. And it automates your deployments, et cetera. I will show you a small bit of that. This is not going to be a Terraform course or whatsoever, just we'll show you the small elements of the Terraform stuff that we actually use to create this infrastructure. Anybody of you using Terraform? No? No. I highly recommend it to manage your infrastructure. We are a big team, so we run 13 or 14 different environments using Terraform. And as you can imagine, not every environment has the same Terraform version. Terraform has the bad tendency that it cannot cope with previous versions. So if you run a environment with, let's say, version 1, and you download version 2, moving forward is no problem. Moving backward is a problem. So you need to manage multiple versions of Terraform. TFEnv is a nice tool that you can use to manage your Terraform versions on the command line. And this is how that can be done. So just a bash script where you install tfenv, you can list all the versions that are currently available for Terraform. So that's something what you do, tfenv list remote. A lot of them. And these are the ones that are installed on my machine. And you can switch easily from one version of Terraform to the other. So if you're considering Terraform, this is a nice one in your toolchain. So in the Terraform stuff, we need to create our infrastructure. We need an ECS cluster. Terraform, you create your infrastructure using code. So you have modules where you can describe, okay, this is my cluster, these are my services, and that kind of stuff. So you can have a multiple, you can have a logical split in the stuff that you do inside Terraform. In this case, I made a decision to use a module ECS cluster, but also use a module VPC. So our environment fits in a virtual private cloud environment of Amazon. So it will not be intermingled with other environments. Those modules can be automatically downloaded from the internet. That means if there's an addition or a change, you can automatically get them. So you have a text file, a main.tf in this example. You just have it. You do Terraform plan or an apply. A plan means that it will take the Terraform code, will check the remote infrastructure, will check if there are changes. If there are no changes, you will be notified. If there are changes, you can see or you can determine if you're going to execute that change. In previous versions, before Terraform, we used CloudFormation. For us, that did not work because it was a bunch of JSON. It was fine, but it was difficult to master and grasp or whatsoever. It was a lot of code. And what we always wanted to see, if we made a change, what is actually the change that's going to be made in the infrastructure? The previous version of CloudFormation, you just change your JSON file, submit it to Amazon, and then after 10 minutes or half an hour, it will state, okay, you have a comma that's missing or whatever, and you have a rollback, and then where is that comma? Because it was programmed in JSON, it was really tedious. I don't have the exact numbers, but we shrunk 80% of our infrastructure code that we needed to manage to deploy our environments. So that was a lot. So Terraform will create an ECS cluster for this with a specific name, a demo cluster, and give you a small overview in that. Oh. So again, this is the ECS console. So you have your clusters over here. I already created the infrastructure because it just takes 5 to 7 minutes or maybe 10 minutes. And this waiting is something I do not like. So we have our cluster. In this case, tfenv demo. I called it cluster. It has one service, and I already deployed a task. We'll come back to that later. But this cluster contains out of several EC2 instances, in this case two, which run in different availability zones immediately. So if one availability zone dies, then automatically it will be targeted to another availability zone. You can have all kinds of metrics on this cluster. So how is the processor load doing in this cluster? So it will do an aggregation of all the machines in the cluster. And it will determine, okay, are we busy or not busy, or are we shortage on memory? So you can base your autoscaling policies based on these metrics. Now, so let me check EC2. And again, you have the same stuff over here. I have three instances running. One of them is a Bastion, where I need to poke into the machines which I actually run in the cluster. I will be showing you a bad habit. Later on, I will go inside the Docker container inside the cluster. Please do not do that, but for the demo effect, that's something that I do. But never do that. So don't state later on, I see bad practice. Indeed, it is bad practice to do that. All right. So we have our infrastructure. We have our VPC, that kind of stuff, so we need to deploy a Docker container. We need some description on how this Docker container should be treated inside Amazon. There are a couple of elements needed in that. And the most basic one is actually, in this case, a task definition. A task definition tells Amazon okay, I have a Docker container or multiple Docker containers inside the task definition, so you can have multiple containers being part of the same task definition. How many memory should I give them? How many CPU credits should I give them? And I'll show you an example later on. So that's the task definition, just a small piece of text file. At the end, you have a service. And that service is actually responsible for maintaining the tasks inside the ECS cluster. So you have described how your container should be managed, CPU-wise, memory-wise, that kind of stuff. And inside the service, you can actually say, okay, I want 2 instances, 3 instances, 4, whatever, or 100. And that's actually the duty of the service. And once you deploy that container, it goes via the scheduler. And at the end, it lands inside your ECS cluster on one of the nodes that are available inside that environment. So how does it look like? You have the task definition in this case. This is not the one I'm using, by the way, but just a plain example. So you have a family of Docker containers. We tend to use one family, one Docker container, so we don't mix and match Docker containers. We have a simple task definition for one single Docker container, but you can combine multiple. You have a container definition, in this case, web. You give your CPU credits, your memory credits, and based on those credits, Amazon will give you some performance credits. Port mappings. So you can state, okay, I have a Docker container, in this case, running on port 8080. How should that be mapped on the host? And we needed this host stuff for our classic ELB things. And we quickly ran into issues. Any of you see the error or the problem with this? So this tells Amazon, launch a Docker container on a host. So if you have one machine, run, or two machines, but let's take one. Run this Docker container. Run the Docker container inside it's 80, and outside it's also 80. So that limits us to having just one Docker container on that host. So we cannot scale this Docker container. So if the first container is being started up, and we tell the service, okay, start a new one, and you have one server, then the whole environment will just complain. I will state, yeah, it's nice that you want to do that, but that port is actually already taken, so it will not be started. If you have two machines in your clusters, that's no problem, because then the container service will actually see, okay, this port is already used on machine one, machine two has a port available, so I will launch that instance on port two. So for that, we need the load balancer, and with the load balancer, in this case, the application load balancer, you can just state, okay, I have a service, and this service has multiple Docker containers without exposing a port, just hook them up to a specific endpoint. And the load balancer actually decides indeed if a request comes in from the internet or whatsoever, can also be internal, to which Docker container this should be routed based on performance characteristics. Again, you have to run a task on ECS. So we have our cluster environment, but you want to kick off a Docker container. You can have multiple ways on doing that. You can have the Amazon console, you can go to the UI, that kind of stuff. That's normally not what we do. We try to automate stuff. You can also use the Amazon CLI. Also not nice, in my opinion. It's just too much, to be honest, in parameters and that kind of stuff. We tend to use Terraform also for that. So we describe our infrastructure in Terraform, but also how our Docker container should be deployed. So we already saw the VPC, we already saw the Bastion, we already saw the ECS cluster. So we have a Hello World service in this case. Forget about the source, that kind of stuff. The basic intention of this thing is to have a module, in this case Hello World service, which has a separate directory structure, which has some separate Terraform files, and load this module and deploy this module. In this case, the desired count is 1, so when we deploy it, one instance of this Docker container will be started on a host, I don't know where, but on a host somewhere. If you have a high traffic site and you want to start already with 10 instances of this Docker container, feel free to do so, but you just can change that one. we will be using autoscaling properties to actually spin up multiple containers if these things get busy, for example, based on the CPU stuff. So this is a task definition. We inject some parameters, let's say where the image can be found, what the version of the Docker container is that we need to deploy, so we can have multiple versions of our cloud infrastructures and also do rolling updates of our Docker containers. Do the memory reservation, and what you see over here is that we do no host mapping. We just have a container port in this case. Let me see what I can show you. In this case, I already deployed one container. And that container is available over here. Where is it? Hello World Endpoint. Hello Grapeconf. Nothing special, just a hoop. There we go. It tells you something. Damn. Tells you something. Nothing special over here. When we want to deploy this environment, we have our Terraform infrastructure. So these are the files that we actually use. So we use the Hello World service, which has some main stuff. And actually, you can do a Terraform plan. In this case, it will check the infrastructure if the service needs to be deployed. We already deployed the service on the cloud infrastructure. So it will come back with there are no changes, hopefully. That's another thing, by the way, Terraform. It tries to go to a possible consistency of your infrastructure. When you roll out your infrastructure using Terraform, sometimes it says I'm complete, but still in the background, some Amazon APIs are still running and not finished with that task. So you need to recheck if everything is finished. Now, let's go into our ECS stuff. What I did over here, I went via the Bastion inside two of our servers inside our cluster. So again, never do this. So in this case, I have an empty machine where we have the ECS agent running. I can do stupid stuff like docker run hello world, fire the command line, and it will do it. In the other one, I have the other application running. See when it was created, that kind of stuff. Now, what I'm going to do, I will create some load. Docker. Exec minus id. So again, never do this, huh? I will go into the container now and cause some stress on this container. I do this now because Amazon needs some time to detect if there's high CPU load or high memory usage. So I will explain this later on, cause stress. No, that will cause stress. So now four CPUs will be doing some something in this container. Zoom out. All right. So that comes brings us to the service autoscaling. If you look in, I can show you that by the way, that's even nicer. If you look inside the infrastructure, so we have the Amazon Container Service. So we have our Docker container over here. Still a thing that sits on 0.05% CPU utilization. You will see later on that it takes a minute or 2 minutes to actually detect that we have a high CPU load. So we have our service over here. Our service has tasks stated there. So you have a task definition. You have a service that's being deployed. And our service has some interesting stuff. It has metrics. Metrics. So here, so you see some spikes coming up. And we have autoscaling groups. Autoscaling stuff. Show you in a moment how this is being done. But this service has been configured when the CPU utilization lower than 90%, lower than 20% has been reached. We will scale down an instance of the Docker container. If we have a high CPU utilization above 20, we will spin up additional containers. Inside the task definition, or inside the scaling policy, you can limit this amount, of course. Otherwise, if you do not look correctly, you end up with 100 containers at the end. So I've set a limit between 1 and 10. So at the moment, in the moment, we will have multiple containers running. So in this case, I still have one task. So let it run. We will see it in a moment. So that scaling has been done on application metrics. The ECS service has a lot of metrics where you can pinpoint CPU, memory, disk I/O, what kind of stuff, and you can scale based on that. And to hook that up together with the auto-scaling, you use CloudWatch in this case. So you set an alarm, a small alarm which you've just seen, where you state, okay, I want to measure on CPU or I want to measure on memory, do something for me. And you can also send email or whatsoever, but I've chosen to just add an additional instance of this Docker container. So in our scaling policy, plus one, minus one will be handled. So may the demo gods be with me. Already, no, still one. No, let me check to CloudWatch if you already have some data. So these are actually the alarms. And inside CloudWatch, you can have dashboards. And indeed, slowly you'll be seeing that this will be spiking. And here you see that it needs some time to actually detect the CPU utilization of this service. And if all goes well, and the UI of this is a bit buggy, to be honest. This is okay, yeah. Now I got an alarm that we have a high CPU load for more than 1 minute. If you try to be smart and say, okay, I want to scale based on 5 seconds, forget about it. They have a hard limit. 1 minute is the lowest possible rating that you can have. So now go to our container service. And we have 2 container instances in this case. So can have the upscaling and downscaling. If I shut down the stress, then it will automatically shut down those containers. That's nice. So we can deploy our Docker images, whatever. The other one. No, the other one is, I can show you. So this is still causing stress somehow. Let me check Docker PS if it's running over here. Oh, Docker PS. So these are the 2 machines. And this just is a new, Amazon has detected that one of my machines is very busy. So the top one is causing a lot of stress inside the cluster, running on one host, and has decided, okay, you're busy. I will create a new instance of that service. I will put it on the next image. And of course, it will have the core stress script in it, but it's not executed. New Docker run. Yeah, and at a certain moment, when the other alarm triggers, it will shut down one of the instances if we drop below a certain CPU. So now, the stress is continuing on one thingy. It will combine all services together and see how much stress all the services have, all the tasks. So what we will see, slowly we see 3, 4, 5, until we are balanced out. Right. So we have our Docker container. Our applications need to talk to other stuff inside our cloud environment. You can take different approaches for that. You can hardwire endpoints and that kind of stuff. We use service discovery for that. That's a nice principle. We can do that on different areas. You can, for example, use DNS-based service discovery. The status, I just show you how I have mounted a DNS record on top of the container. So you can also do the same with your Docker container. So have an ELB that has a DNS endpoint. So you can point to that DNS entry from your other containers. So then they can find each other. You can use something like console. Are you aware of console, using it already? No? Now what console actually is when you launch a Docker instance, it actually registers inside console, and other applications can look inside console to see, okay, I need a service, a banking service, where can I find that service? So if you have multiple services, multiple Docker containers that are added to console, you will get a list of services that you can use inside your cloud infrastructure. And your applications can use that information based on round robin, like load balancer inside your application using Feyn or whatsoever. That goes a bit out of this scope. So logging, service discovery is something, use DNS or something like console, that helps you a lot. Logging, it's problematic because we have a lot of Docker containers, we have services, and we need to wire up stuff together. How can we get logging inside this infrastructure? We can use the native tooling from Amazon. We can do our own stuff, so till stuff or pull STD out or whatsoever. But we need smarter things for that. So our Docker containers have so-called logging drivers. There's also a logging driver for AWS, for CloudWatch. That means that every log element that is being sent out by an application will be sent to the specific log driver. So you can have a CloudWatch log driver, you can have a Fluentd log driver, which I will show you later on. You can have a whatever, name it, log driver. So every output goes to that destination. If you use a standard one, the JSON file stuff, at the end you will run out of this space because it will just pump out the logging information to the host. So how do you configure your log driver? You just add a log configuration to that task definition, and you say what kind of log driver you want to use. In this case, AWS logs. Where does it need to go? Where is the region that where it needs to go? And some prefixes. I'm not very in favor of using CloudWatch as being a log driver, to be honest. The reason behind that is that for single log entries, that's nice. But for example, if you have a stack trace inside your application, the Docker daemon will just send out every element in that stack trace as a single log statement. So if you have multiple services that are logging to a CloudWatch group, for example, you get a mix of data that's just intertwined. And it's very difficult to find the correct information. For monitoring, you can use also CloudWatch, which I've done. Other stuff like Influx, Prometheus, Sysdig. CloudWatch is the de facto one, which you get for free. Again, I'm not very in favor of that, but it's a hosted system, so it's managed by Amazon, and it more or less works. But you can also do other things, like for example Prometheus. CloudWatch has those limits of 1 minute. We tend to use Prometheus for this. If you want to have more information on Prometheus, I will do another talk on Prometheus, how we do this inside our infrastructure. But actually, we scrape our endpoints or our Docker containers on a very regular basis. And we have a nice dashboard with meters, which we can follow our infrastructure in real time. So CloudWatch gives you an interval of 1 minute, but I want to have alerts within 5 seconds if a container goes down or a service goes down. I don't want to wait for another minute, for example, if my customers start to complain. I want to do preemptive alerting for if I detect, for example, that a specific instance inside my cluster is running out of disk space within 4 hours, I want to get a notification of that. And with Prometheus, that's something I can do. I'm out of time. Wanted to do a demo on Prometheus. If you want to see that, you have to stay until the end of the day. Any questions? No? Thanks very much. Have a nice day.